we first look at the Butterworth possibility now. We will look at the design of analog low pass filters using the Butterworth approximation. Now you see, in the Butterworth approximation, you want the pass band and the stop band both to be monotonic. So obviously, if you want the pass band to be monotonic and the stop band to be monotonic, the only sensible way of doing it is to let the magnitude decrease starting from zero frequency all the way down to the edge of the pass band, and then again starting from the edge of the stop band all the way down to infinity. That seems to be the most sensible way to do it. Which means you need, you see, now that's another interesting thing. Since we are dealing only with magnitudes, we shall not design the system function of the analog filter directly. What we will design instead is what is called the magnitude complex system function. So, in general, we introduce the idea of what is called a magnitude squared system function. And a magnitude squared system function is essentially the analog system function, or the system function of the analog filter, which we will call H analog of S multiplied by H analog of minus S, and we will explain why that is the case. You see, you want to take the magnitude squared of H analog j omega, isn't it? What you want is what we want to design is mod H analog j omega the whole squared. Well, I mean, you could say you want to design mod H analog omega, j omega, that's also all right, but then, I mean, it's much easier to do squared, as we'll see in a minute. They're equivalent, because it's all non-negative. So, you see, mod H analog j omega whole squared can also be rewritten as H analog j omega multiplied by H analog j omega complex conjugate. But remember, we are going to have real coefficients in H analog of S. They are all going to be real coefficients in S. So when we take the complex conjugate, the real coefficients remain unchanged, but S gets complex conjugated. So, you know, we could have written S conjugate, or you see, since you are talking about j omega, the complex conjugate of j omega is minus j omega. So, even if we write minus s there, we would get the complex conjugate. So, in fact, what we are saying is, we want H analog s into H analog minus s evaluated over S equal to j omega. That's because taking the complex conjugate amounts to replacing j omega minus j omega. Now, you may wonder, why did we not write H analog S complex conjugate? You see, what we want to ultimately design is what is called an analytic function of S. Now, if we use a complex conjugate on S, then what we get is a non-analytic function. The moment you complex conjugation does not allow for derivatives in the first place. Forget about any higher order kinds of differentiation. So, we cannot use S complex conjugate, but we can use minus S. Minus S will retain the analyticity, and therefore, we choose minus S over S conjugate. Anyway, so we have chosen to design H analog S into H analog minus S. And of course, what we have to do is design this compound system, and then we have to identify which of its zeros and poles correspond to H analog S and which of its zeros and poles correspond to H analog minus S. But that is not a difficult job at all. We know that we want the filter to be stable. And the analog domain in the S plane, if stability is the case, in fact not just stability, we want it to be positive real. And positive realness means all the zeros and all the poles must be on the left half side of the S plane. So, once we have the collection of zeros and poles corresponding to this product H analog S into H analog minus S, it is very easy to identify what is H analog S. Take all the zeros and poles in the left half plane and put them into H analog S, automatically all the minus S go into H analog minus S. That is easy. So, you see, if you want a monotonic response for, you see, you want H analog j omega mod squared to monotonically decrease in pass band and stop band. So, it must have its maximum at omega equal to 0 and then it must steadily decrease as you move from 0 to infinity. That is the kind of response that we want. Now, of course, the response at 0 should not blow up without bound. It must be finite. In fact, it is most convenient to make it 1. And then you want the response to die. So, what can we envisage as a function of omega? Now, remember, we are taking H analog j omega into H analog minus j omega. So, therefore, the product is a magnitude squared function. It is necessarily going to be a real function of omega. So, I need to look for a real function of omega, and the simplest real function of omega, which monotonically decreases as you go from 0 to infinity, is essentially a function where the denominator monotonically increases and you want it to be rational. So, denominator must of course be a rational function. In fact, why rational? The simplest thing to do is to choose the denominator to be a polynomial. And what simpler polynomial can you have than a polynomial which has a constant term and another term which increases monotonically with omega. In other words, what we are envisaging is a magnitude squared function that looks like this. Now you want it to be non-negative. So, you have omega by some parameter, positive parameter. The whole to the power 2n. Now, let us understand this. You see, why have we chosen this? As we anticipated, at omega equal to 0, this is 1 and therefore, the response starts at 1. As omega goes from 0 to infinity, this the denominator monotonically increases from 0 to infinity and therefore, this fraction monotonically decreases from 1 towards 0. And further, this omega c, why have we introduced omega c and why have we introduced n? You see, n controls the rate at which the response drops. And omega c controls the point at which the response reaches a certain value. So, for example, at omega equal to omega c, this is 1 and therefore, this magnitude squared reaches what is called the half power point. The magnitude squared becomes half and therefore, that is called the half power point. If you were to put in a sinusoid in the analog domain into the filter, then that sinusoid would come out with half power at omega equal to omega c. So, the point of half power changes as you change omega c. And how fast the response drops after omega c is controlled by n. The larger the n, the faster it drops. Now, using just these two parameters, omega c and n, we shall be able to meet any magnitude specifications that we choose. Let us see how. So, let us assume that you have arrived at the magnitude specifications as follows. This I am talking about now the analog domain. You have a pass band edge, a stop band edge. In the pass band, you have agreed that you want the response to be between 1 plus delta 1 and 1 minus delta 1, and in the stop band, you don't want it to be beyond delta 2. And the pass band edge is at omega p, and the stop band edge is at omega s. And this is the analog frequency omega. Now, we shall see in a minute that we can meet this by using the Butterworth filter. Now, in fact, we can, you know, do a little better. In the Butterworth filter, we don't even need this. We do not even need 1 plus delta 1. We can remain between 1 and 1 minus delta 1 in the pass band. And in fact, it's very easy. We'll write down the equations that we need to satisfy. You see, what we want is that at the passband edge, 1 by 1 plus omega p divided by omega c to the power 2n must be greater than or equal to 1 minus delta 1, the whole squared. Remember, we're talking about squared magnitude. And the second equation that we have is at the edge of the stop band, at omega s, it must be less than or equal to delta 2 squared. And now it's very easy to solve these two equations. In fact, these are all non-negative quantities. So if we multiply both sides by a non-negative number, then we're dealing with inequalities here. So when we multiply both sides of an inequality, we have to be careful whether we are multiplying by a non-negative number or a negative number. Here, luckily, all of them happen to be non-negative. Anyway, you know, let's take the first inequality and let's note that, so let's give them numbers. Let's call this inequality 1 and let's call this inequality 2. From inequality 1, we have 1 by 1 minus delta 1 squared minus 1 is greater than or equal to omega p by omega c to the power 2n. And the second inequality, we take the reciprocal. Now, when we take the reciprocal, of course, the inequality is reversed. They are all non-negative quantities. So, if I take the reciprocal of both sides, the inequality is reversed. And of course, luckily, none of the sides is zero. So, reciprocal is acceptable. So, we take the reciprocal of the second. And you get 1 by delta 2 squared is less than or equal to 1 plus omega s by omega c whole to the power 2n. Therefore, we have 1 by delta 2 squared minus 1 is less than or equal to omega c by omega s by omega c to the power 2n. So now we have two inequalities here. You see, what we need to do is to first eliminate one, we have to solve for the two quantities, omega c and n. You see, so what are the design parameters here? Omega c and n. All right? You see, let's give these quantities names. So, you know, now let's observe these two equations that we have here. Let's write them down again. So we'll proceed as follows. We'll obtain n first and then omega c. So to obtain n first, we need to do away with omega c first, right? From the two equations, we flash the equations before you again. So we have these two equations here, which we have converted back into these two equations here, right? Now please note, let's make a few observations about these quantities here. 1 minus delta 1 squared is a quantity less than 1. So therefore, this quantity is going to be greater than 1 for sure, and minus 1 is therefore going to be positive. On the other hand, if you look at this quantity here, delta 2 squared is again significantly less than 1. So 1 by delta 2 squared is significantly greater than 1, right? And therefore, this minus 1 is going to be positive, right? So both of these are positive. Now we can take the logarithm on both sides, right? So in fact, you know, you could, the logarithm is a non-negative operation, is that right? So logarithm is a monotonic operation which works on non-negative arguments. In fact, it's what is called a strictly monotonic. So, you know, there's no place where it stabilizes or plateaus. So, if I take the logarithm on both sides of an inequality of non-negative quantities, that inequality is preserved. So let me take the logarithm of both sides. And let's give the name 1 by 1 minus delta 1 squared minus 1 to be d1 and 1 by delta 2 squared minus 1 to be d2. So we have, and of course, both of them are greater than 0 as we've observed, right? So we, the first equation that we have is d1 is greater than or equal to omega p by omega c to the power 2n. And the second equation that we have is d2 is less than or equal to omega s by omega c to the power 2n. Now, if we take the logarithm as we do, we have 2n times log omega p minus log omega c is less than or equal to log d1. And of course, log d2 is less than or equal to 2n times log omega s minus log omega c. Now, you know, what we want to do is to subtract these two inequalities, to get rid of log omega c, in a way. And the most convenient thing to do is to reverse this inequality by taking the negative on both sides. So let's reverse the inequalities. So we have log d1 or minus log d1 is less than or equal to 2n log omega c minus log omega p, and log d2 is less than or equal to 2n log omega s minus log omega c. Simple. And now we can just add. Now we can just add these inequalities. Is that right? And that does away with, you see, log d2 minus log d1 is log d2 by d1. And this is less than equal to 2n times log omega s by omega p. And why we've chosen this form is because omega s is greater than omega p. So this logarithm is positive. Omega s is, of course, the stop band is more than the path stop band edge is more than the pass band edge. And therefore, omega s by omega p is a quantity greater than 1, so its logarithm would be positive. And now the question is, what about d2 and d1? Remember, d2 is 1 by delta 2 squared minus 1. Now, delta 2 squared is much less, or less definitely, than 1 by delta 1, 1 minus delta 1 squared. So, d2 is definitely greater than d1. d2 is 1 by delta 2 squared minus 1. Delta 2 squared is lower than 1 minus delta 1 squared. So, 1 by delta 2 squared is more than 1 by 1 minus delta 1 squared. And therefore, d2 is greater than d1 as well. And therefore, we have positive quantities on both sides of this inequality here. So, we are in good shape. And now, we have a very simple relationship. N, therefore, turns out to be greater than or equal to half log d2 by d1 divided by log omega s by omega p. And this is what governs the choice of what is called the order. N is the rate at which the response decays. And N has a direct relationship to how much of resource you are going to require to realize the filter. That's not too difficult to see. You see, once you have N, it tells you what is the power of S. You see, after all, omega or j omega is S. So, a higher power of S means a higher power of Z. And a higher power of Z means more delays, more additions, more multiplications. So, N has a direct bearing on the amount of resource that you require to realize the filter. So, N, let's make a remark here. N is a reflection of the resource requirement of the filter. The more the N, the more resources you need to invest in realizing the filter. And in fact, if we look just for a minute at the expression for N, then we'll see that it's very, very intuitively clear why this is a reflection of resource. Let us see how N, now remember, N is greater than or equal to some quantity. Now, this quantity need not be an integer. So, what must you do? You must put here what you call a ceiling operation. A ceiling operation means the integer just above that. So, for example, suppose this quantity works out to be 6.4, then the ceiling of that is 7. If it works out to be 7.9, the ceiling is 8. If it works out to be 5.1, the ceiling is 6. So, if it's a little wee bit above 5, the ceiling goes up by one step. The ceiling is the integer just above. So, n must be greater than or equal to the ceiling of that quantity. Now, let's look at the quantity itself for a minute and make some inferences. You see, it is very clear that n, the requirement on n is going to be more if the numerator is more or if the denominator is less. Let's first look at the denominator. When would the denominator be less? The denominator would be less if omega s and omega p are close to one another. If omega s is far away from omega p, the denominator is more. And therefore, the requirement of order goes down. So, asking for a very sharp transition band means asking for a higher order. Now, let's look at the numerator. In the numerator, d1, you see, when would the numerator be more? Either when d2 is more or when d1 is less. If d2 is more, you are saying that 1 by delta 2 squared is more, and that means delta 2 squared is less. That means you are asking for smaller tolerance in the stop band. If you are asking for smaller tolerance in the stop band, you are demanding more, and therefore you have to invest more resources. On the other hand, if d1 is less, then 1 by 1 minus delta 1 squared is less. That means 1 minus delta 1 squared is more. That means you are reducing the tolerance in the pass band. And that means you are again asking for more, and therefore you have to invest more. Engineering design, whether it is in discrete time system design or in any other branch of engineering, is always a game of ask for more, invest more. When you ask for more, you have to invest more. And that is true for all the three kinds of asking here. If you ask for a sharper transition band, you have to invest more. If you ask for a smaller stop band tolerance, you have to invest more. If you ask for a smaller pass band tolerance, you have to invest more. Ask for more, invest more. Simple. Now, of course, once you've completed the choice of n, and you know, now you understand why you had a 2n there. You had a 2n because you took h analog s into h analog minus s. So, you know, whatever poles and zeros you have in the original h analog are doubled when you go into h analog s into h analog minus s. That's why you put 2n there. And anyway, you are considering the magnitude squared function. So, you need to double. Now, this n is called the order. We will give it a name. N is called the order of the filter. More demand, more order. Finding out omega c is very easy. Finding out omega c is very easy. You see, you could go back to the equation that we had here. Once you found n, finding omega c is very easy. You had this equation earlier. D1 is greater than or equal to omega p by omega c to the power n, and this is true. Now, all that we need to do is to take omega c to the other side in both of them. We have from the first equation, from this equation, we would have omega c to the power 2n is greater than or equal to omega p to the power 2n divided by d1. And from the second equation, taking omega c to the power 2n here and bringing this here, you have omega c to the power 2n is less than or equal to omega s to the power n by d2. So now you have a beautiful range in which omega c can lie. Of course, omega c is a positive quantity. So, if you know omega c to the power 2n, you can find out omega c by taking the 1 by 2nth root. Or you can use logarithms, that's not a problem. But what we can see from here is that omega c to the power 2n must lie between omega s to the power 2n by d2 and omega p to the power 2n by d1. And any omega c satisfying this will do. Any omega c which satisfies this inequality will do. You may wonder why you got a range of omega c which is acceptable. That is because n took a ceiling operation. So, in n you took a ceiling operation. So, you introduced some amount of tolerance there, and therefore you got a range of omega c which is possible. If that you know, when you had the expression for n, if the right hand side happened to be an integer, then you would get no tolerance here. You would get a strict value of omega c. But because you have brought a ceiling operation there, you have introduced some tolerance. So therefore, you have a range of omega c to choose from. Any omega c which satisfies this inequality will do in this range. Is that right? So yes, there's a question. Well, so the question is, does omega c lie between omega p and omega s? Well, that is not necessary. It depends on the tolerances that you have given. Omega c is the half power point. If your passband tolerance is more than half power, then of course omega c lies inside the passband. So omega c is only the half power point. That's all that can be said. Anyway, with this then we come to the end of this lecture. In the next lecture, we'll proceed further to complete the design of the Butterworth filter.